Hello and welcome to our first video looking at the basic forms and features of T.S. Eliot's poetry. As we go through this introduction to Preludes, please make sure you are marking up your copy of the poem using coloured pens and that you have some blank paper to make notes. We're going to go quite quickly, so please keep up. Here I have a list of relevant poetic devices. If you're not sure about any of these techniques, please pause the video now and look some up. We also have this list of vocabulary terms to describe the poem. I suggest you make note of these terms and you practice using them. To start, let's look at the title of Preludes. What is a prelude? It is a short musical piece that precedes a more important musical composition. We're going to have a look at how T.S. Eliot's poetry is highly musical through the techniques he has used. And we're also going to look at the idea that this is a bit of a parody of a romantic poem, which would look at how important life is in relation to the sublime creation of nature. Whereas T.S. Eliot is looking at how all of life is mechanical and meaningless in the modern industrialized city. We open with personification of the winter evening settling down, which is of course pathetic fallacy. Winter is a time of death, and this poem has a highly melancholic tone. It is sad, it is downcast. This is really expressed through the sibilance, that is a repeated S sound. Whenever sibilance occurs in this poem, think about the sense of threat that gives you in the modern industrialized environment. We also have the musicality of the poem here. We can see iambic tetrameter, not pentameter, which is five. Tetrameter is four emphasized syllables. This poem is musical. We have the motif of time begin, 6 o'clock. What is 6 o'clock? It is the time workers come home. And it's the time people are settling down. However, the persona of this poem isn't inside eating steak, he is outside. It's this sense of enclosed intimacy the persona has with the other people in the city. Though they're not part of the community, they remain alienated, they're still surrounded by the waste created in the metropolis. Look at this motif of time. The metaphor, the burnt out ends of smoky days. This is the setting of the poem. It is a setting at a time of waste, a time of decay. The second person and the emotive adjectives here add to that tone. As does the alliteration. Broken, blinds, beat. These words create a sense of a strike, and they have an effect on the ear, an effect on the musicality of the poem. We also end with the important symbol of the lighting of the lamps. This is an important symbol in T.S. Eliot's poetry, so pay attention to the motif of light in this poem. In Prelude number 2, we again open with personification and sibilance. Prelude number 2 is very much an extension of Prelude number 1. We also see the olfactory imagery, though it's not the smell of steaks in passageways, it's now the faint, stale smells of beer. Again, emotive imagery, stale smells of beer, sawdust trampled, muddy feet and dingy shades. Synecdoche is an important technique that comes up here. In synecdoche, we are representing the people of the city, not as whole people, but just as muddy feet, just as hands raising dingy shades. What are these people doing? Well, they are acting within a pretense of a meaningful life. It's a masquerade. This masquerade is an important metaphor within the poem, and it continues when we look at the motif of light in dingy shades. It's this idea of a curtain being raised on an act of meaningful life. We end with this hyperbole, 1,000 furnished rooms, an idea that this meaningless existence is happening again and again and again. This idea of uniformity within the industrialized city is a factor of industry. So it's important we recognize this as a contextual element of the poem. We see in prelude number 3, the perspective is very different. Look at all of this these examples of second person pronouns. Who is you? Of course it is the reader. Many people also claim that the you is a prostitute, because look at the sexual connotations of those first few lines. We have the setting of a bed, it's very racy for 1910, 1911, and we've got the character lying upon their back. Who is the character? Well, it could be a woman taking curling papers from their hair. Could also be a man with yellow soles of feet and soiled hands. It's this idea of the you as the reader, the poet, and a sordid hermaphrodite character. We also have T.S. Eliot himself recognizing that these are sordid images. When we look at the verb choice, how are these images playing? They're flickering against the ceiling. Moving pictures, films, are still new at this point, and many people said that they would flicker. So this has a dreamlike quality here. It has a quality of being an act, in the same way the Masquerade did in Prelude 2. We've got the motif of light continuing. Symbolism of sparrows in the gutters breaks up the poem, breaks up this prelude, because the sparrows may be a sign of spring finally arriving. But where are they? Are they on the branch in nature? No, they're in the gutter. So that is also an exercise in juxtaposition. We have a metonym. What does the street stand for? The street is a phrase that stands in for the world, the people of the city, who don't understand the decay they're living in. And we finish with this extension of synecdoche. Again, they're not whole people. They are just feet and hands which move mechanically. Prelude 4 ends the poem, and it was written much later. So we can see T.S. Eliot extending himself again here. We start with his soul, the third person. This might be a religious allusion to Christ stretched out across the sky. Many people also see it as a connection to the images that flickered across the ceiling. We then move into the first person. This is perhaps the most personal element of the poem. I am moved by fancies. And it's here we get the idea that the persona is an aesthete. They care about the aesthetic world. And then we finally end with the second person again. Wipe your hand across your mouth and laugh. It's a hopeless ending to this poem about a sordid, meaningless existence. We have the motif of time, though before, where time was certain, here it's 4 and 5 and 6 o'clock. Although this poem is a prelude to the more important aspects of life, we can see that the prelude has stretched out throughout the day. And we see synecdoche again, connected to the connotations of these verb choices. They're trampled by insistent feet, short square fingers stuffing pipes. These are not feeling people like the poet down here. These are simply part of a mass. The evening newspapers contribute to our idea of waste within the city. Your newspapers came up before when they circled around the feet of the persona. Here we see evening newspapers are a metonym for waste that is created. Basically, when these newspapers were printed in the evening, we already knew that they are going to be rubbish immediately. A bit of a message about human industry and human progress there. We've got the paradox. What are the newspapers telling us? They're telling us certain certainties, not the real truth. And we've got personification, the conscience of a blackened street impatient to assume the world, which is a metaphor. We also have the metaphor, the notion of some infinitely gentle, infinitely suffering thing. Keep in mind that is certainly parallelism, beautiful phrase. It is a religious illusion. The persona is here a Christ-like, childlike figure within the terrible world of industry. And we finish with this simile. The worlds revolve like ancient women gathering fuel in vacant lots. Please keep in mind this is the only simile I've pointed out in this poem. It is very important that it's a different technique. The fact that it's only been used once makes it more significant. This continuation of circular imagery in revolve shows that the prelude is not going to end. We are not coming up to a more meaningful life. It's continuing to circle with these ancient women. Thank you very much for watching our first video. Please bring your annotated copy of the poem to our next class.